All right, hey everybody, welcome to Spinalpedia's Disability Employment Success Stories. My name is Tiffany Carlson, and I'm the Executive Director of Spinalpedia.com. So today we are joined by Bill Fertig, and he is from Virginia Beach, and we are very excited to welcome him because he's going to share his employment journey and his injury story with us. So hey Bill, welcome to the video.
Hey, Tiffany, thanks for the invite. Happy to be speaking with you today.
We're very, very excited to have you on, too. I was reading a little bit about you on your Facebook page, and I just really was excited to see that you do work for United Spinal, and I love what they do. And so it'll be fun to talk to you about what you do for them. But before we talk to you about your job, I'd love to kind of begin with how you were injured and how old you are. Just, you know, a little background, if you don't mind sharing. So if you
sure. How did we get to this point from here?
Yeah, right? I know.
So I was originally in law enforcement, and I had an off-duty motorcycle accident in 1999. And that resulted in my T7 complete paraplegia. And so, you know, those sets of answers to those questions, that went away, and we had to look at answering a different set of questions. So, you know, the pathway eventually led me to working in the spinal cord injury resource center.
That's crazy. And, you know, I think when you have an injury at 45 years old, right, around there?
Right, that's correct.
That's a life, that's the middle of your life, and you're almost midlife. So I always wonder, how do you go from being, you know, a police officer and living that world to suddenly, you know, you're a paraplegic? We already know how that transition can be difficult, but then finding a new employment, you know, direction can be hard. So how did you decide you wanted to do some nonprofit work?
Well, so I actually did not decide that I wanted to do nonprofit work.
Okay.
Like a lot of things, that career path found me. And I think that the important thing is when you find that you're on a new course, is you need to be able to put yourself out there, and you need to be open to, you know, new possibilities, because the old set of questions I had answered, and now there were a totally different set of questions. So yeah. I can't tell you how many different types of positions that I applied to in the 5-year period from when I was injured, went through rehab, got home, got adjusted, and then I did go back on ticket to work for a period of 5 years.
Cool.
Where I was working part-time in the 911 dispatch center. So that gave me the freedom to build some computer skills, which I had none.
Okay.
At the time. This is 1999, and I was mid-career.
Right.
I was looking at, okay, I'm really not going to have to be a computer expert. I'm not going to have to do it. I'm not going to do it.
Right.
I have my career path. I'm going to retire and, and not really have to get there. So
yeah,
I saw it coming, and I chose not to get involved in it, and that didn't really hold up very long. So. I was very happy. I didn't know at the time that Ticket to Work was a brand new program in early 99.
Oh, yeah.
It ended in September of 99, but it worked tremendously well for me because it got me back out into the workforce, building new skills,
yeah,
making connections, and having some time to react and to think. And,
yeah.
And so, you know, it was all computer-aided dispatching. So I went straight into 3 monitors, 3 keyboards, 1 headset, paying attention with the other ear, everything going on in the room. So pretty fast-paced environment, and that and some supplemental classes helped me gain computer skills for a new position.
That's pretty great. So how long after your rehab and going home did you start working again when you first had made your first paycheck? Because I think
so,
that can work fast.
Yep. So Social Security disability went through seamlessly. Mm-hmm. I know it can be a problem sometimes, but if you just cross the T's and dot the I's and get it submitted properly, you know, my former benefits carried me over until SSDI kicked in.
Yeah.
And then I worked a ticket to work, but I went back to part-time employment in 10 months.
That's crazy. That's awesome.
Too early.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I made it from working 16-hour shifts sometimes, you know, and looking at the clock 4 hours into a shift.
Yeah.
When, you know, let's face it, you're somewhat beat down and a little bit debilitated. Yeah, you don't have all your strength back for a year or more after your injury. But I'm glad that I did it that way because I had the opportunity at that time.
Yeah.
So that I didn't end up getting stuck too long.
Absolutely. I mean, do you feel it was good for you psychologically to get back to work too?
Absolutely. I have to tell you, everybody has a different kind of personality, different kind of approach. Mm-hmm. Mine served me very, very well. As I was, I'm still very much a black and white person without that much gray.
Yeah.
In the middle, and for a lot of things, it's either going to be this way or it's going to be that way. And when I finally came to out of whatever drug-induced state they had me in after injury, and realized that I'd now be using a wheelchair, mm-hmm. I really adjusted to that in a day.
Really?
I wasn't exactly a happy camper, but I made that adjustment. I made that switch in a day or two.
That's pretty crazy.
The thing that lingered for me that was very stressful and upsetting mm-hmm. was having lost my career path.
Yeah.
That's what was the hard thing for me. So it was very rewarding to get back to work in that same area.
That's awesome. And that's fast, but for a lot of people, that's what they need to do. I was going to ask, so did you have any assistance, like when you went back to school, or did you have to go back to school or receive, when you did you receive any state vocational supports or anything like that?
So, vocational rehabilitation, it seems to me, is as good as the counselor that you're working with. Mm-hmm. Programs are there. They're there to help people. My very first counselor was very inexperienced. The things that I needed at the time, when I asked them, every answer was no, and it did not seem to be meaningful for me. So I broke away from it, and as I trudged along my own merry path by myself, mm-hmm. Applying for all kinds of crazy positions during that 5-year period, mm-hmm. And not really finding exactly what I wanted, that part-time work allowed me to go back out to use the wheelchair accessible equipment at the old rehab center. Yeah. It was open in the middle of the day. And it was when I was out there, staying in shape, that I ran into a different folk rehab counselor mm-hmm. who I did meld very well with. And mm-hmm. he brought me back in the next week. We reopened the case. And I always kid him and tell him he's batting 1,000 because mm-hmm. a couple weeks later, after we had a long talk and he knew what I wanted and what I was looking for, mm-hmm. he sent me one job notice, and that was this one. So I tell him, he's been 1,000.
Wow. And that's the job that you have at the United Spinal Association, right?
Correct.
So let's talk about your position and like what you do in it and your title and all exactly, sure. You know.
Sure. So I'm the director of the Spinal Cord Injury Resource Center, mm-hmm. and that's got a bunch of different components, but the most important component is our personnel. So we're a six-person team. We have myself, I live with paraplegia, three of us live with quadriplegia, and then our two non-injured staff members are our social worker and our spinal cord injury rehabilitation nurse. Okay. And so between us, we have the four of us that are injured, we have a combined number of years living with spinal cord injury and the experience that comes with that of 84 years.
Wow.
So we've all been injured a while and we've all seen a lot of things and solved a lot of problems for ourselves and therefore can help other people with that. And the time working in the resource center as a unit, if we add all those up, mm-hmm. again, that comes up into the 60s, about 65 years total experience for the group.
That's so a lot.
Personnel is our biggest asset.
So you're helping people with, it's kind of a broad title. So what exactly do you do on like an average day?
Very good question. So it is a broad way that I described it. But you know, one way I answer that is that, you know, there's really no question that we don't get. Mm-hmm. And whether it be a scenario of a brand new injury where, which is, we really want to talk to the families as early as possible. If they're in the trauma center setting or a step down unit and the current question is where to go to rehab, mm-hmm. we want to be on the phone with you there to yeah. point you in the right direction so your loved one doesn't get slipped through the cracks and not go to a robust spinal cord injury specific rehabilitation center. And so that's critically important. Family members have needs, individuals have needs. Even once through the rehab process, mm-hmm. You have durable medical equipment questions and needs, health concerns, oh, yeah. Employment concerns. How do you go about getting back to employment like we're talking about today?
Yeah. Yeah.
And pretty much everything from soup to nuts.
That's awesome. And you do it all virtually as well from your place.
We do. We have extensive, we have literally tens of thousands of pages of online information that's categorized into, I believe, 47 knowledge books by topic area. Okay. And just one of those books is our state-by-state and local resource. So that's a very big book in and of itself. So we have a lot of materials that we can send and we can leverage to get people pointed in the right direction.
What a great job. So is your position a full-time one? And you have to like, that's fantastic. So
it's wow. It's full-time plus because a lot of us are pretty dedicated to it. So, you know, you don't really just turn everything off at 5 when you have a couple of people still in need of something.
That's really, really nice. So you're helping people whenever you're awake, basically at all hours from your home.
Pretty much. And, you know, a lot of people figure, well, it's great working from home, which, by the way, it is. I'm not going to say it's not.
Oh,
but
yeah.
You do get a little claustrophobic, so you get to plan a little some side trips.
Absolutely. Yeah, we meet some people. Yep.
Get yourself out there. But also, you know, I have more of a tendency to work 9, maybe 9.5, 10 hours sometimes because mm-hmm. you're right there and I could just do that one more thing.
that's a lot of hours, but you love what you do, it sounds like. So I do too, and it makes it a lot better when you're not.
You know, we're very proud of our case closure surveying.
Oh, okay.
For the last 3 years, whenever we, in our case management system that we use, when you join membership and ask a question or just find us on the website or call us and we create a case,
cool.
Upon case closure, you would then get an opportunity to complete a survey.
Okay.
Three basic questions of how timely was the response, how helpful, yeah. and would you refer the service to others, as well as there's a free text section for you to give us that great testimonial. So overall time we've been running the case closure surveying, the median scores are 10 across all three questions. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's great for people to know who are listening that the United Spinal offers that. I knew you did that work, but I didn't realize you had so many people dedicated to that. That's really awesome. So do you receive any reasonable accommodations at work, and how do they help you perform in your position?
Funny you should ask that. So through the whole injury scenario, I had 30 fractures and a head injury, so I had do a couple of things a little bit differently. I use an ergonomically shaped keyboard. I actually already had it, so I didn't have to have, you know, work provided for me, but it's one that where the two halves are sort of bent in the middle and your fingers can come in at an angle, and it's raised also. And that's just super fast for me to type on versus the straight kind of a keyboard like you might find on a laptop. The other thing that I'm going to be doing here is I'm setting up a multiple workstation. I don't know if you can see briefly in the side there. There's a standing frame, which admittedly I have not been using enough. So we're actually right now setting up a duplicate workstation scenario where I'll have two screens, two keyboards, and I'll work half of my day in my standard.
Oh, that's a super smart idea, Bill. I need to do that.
That'll be awesome. A good day.
Fabulous. So, okay. And so did you have to, so I kind of already know the answer to this question, but I'm going to ask it you anyways. Did you have to record, you already had the keyboard. So it sounds like you don't have any other accommodations you had to ask for, but for people maybe that need to ask an employer for accommodations, do you have any advice on how to do that?
Sure. Absolutely. I made a couple modifications to the desk area. I had a, just below the work surface, there was a typical, you know, pencil drawer, kind of a rollout drawer, and that was in the way, so I had to remove that.
Okay.
But those are examples of very simple barrier removal that you could ask your employer to help set up for you at work if you're in a physical office space.
Yeah.
Or if you're working from home and you need some funding to do those minor modifications. And the kind of agency that will help support you in working with your employer to make those modifications that allow you to be successful in employment is JAM, Job Accommodation Network. So we will routinely connect people with JAM just for the support to know that, yes, they're on the right track. Yes, these are the laws and what an employer is responsible for. And JAM is very good at massaging those employer relationships to help get that accommodation in place for you.
Do you know their website off the top of your head so we so anyone can visit them?
We will examine that during the rest of the interview.
Let's do that. Well, let's do that. We'll share it later, but that's really good information. Thank you for sharing that. So great. So I guess I have a couple more questions and we should be almost done. So what do you like most about your job and being employed?
Well, you know, it's very gratifying to find that when someone calls our resource center, and unfortunately this has happened way too many times, mm-hmm. that they're getting thoroughly thwarted by the system, mm-hmm. And not able to get the right type of therapy, or not able to get, you know, the right type of equipment mm-hmm. approved for them, that we can help make that solution. I'll give you an example. Okay. We had a father a few years ago call and point out that his son in his early 20s was being denied access to spinal cord injury specific rehabilitation. And he indicated that the insurance company, in quotes, indicated to him, he'll never get any better, we're not paying for rehab.
Ooh.
Right. And this was a very solid advocate type of a father. He just needed to know that he was on the right path.
Yeah.
And after talking to our information specialists, we empowered him to go in and put his foot down with the hospital that was trying to discharge his young son to a nursing home, put his foot down with the insurance company, and we were also able to provide to the father some clear examples of highly successful people having gone through rehab at the same type of injury level, and that helped him quickly win that argument with his insurer and got his son into rehab.
Wow.
And that young man, this is 5 years later, that young man is on his feet. he's continuing after his quality inpatient rehab
wow.
with activity-based therapy, and he is actually trying to increase his distance that he's stepping now because he's doing that well.
What a fantastic story. So this is what you get paid to do. Of course you love your job.
It is. We get paid to sometimes do great stuff and help parents do successful things. And that's very rewarding.
What a great story.
And I pulled up Jan's website is www.accessjam.com. askjan, J-A-N as in Nancy, .org.
.org. All right. Thank you for looking that up. That's awesome. So, okay. So we kind of already talked about this earlier. Why do you think being employed with a disability is important? But do you have anything more to say on that topic?
So I think that for almost anyone, mm-hmm. Employment is a part of who you are, irrespective of disability or not. You know, your work life is a large chunk of time. It's a large effort. It's a large part of your life, and it becomes part of you. Mm-hmm. And you are many things, but a big part of what you are is what you do.
It's true.
And how you do it and what your reputation is in that field and everything else that goes along with it. So, you know, to me, it's almost like, if I was, and I experienced this when I got injured, it's like somebody chopped off a third of my life and took it away. I was fortunately able to find a way back to replace that third of life. Because I think a lot of people are lost without it.
It's so true. I think a lot of people need to find a job they love, though, after their injury, because sometimes you just can't do it. It's important. You can't just do a job that sucks your soul out of you, though. That can be hard.
Yeah.
So, what advice would you give to people with disabilities who are interested in working? This is the final question.
So, okay. I think I'll just address that in a very general way.
Okay.
Because, mm-hmm. you know, when I was between positions. Mm-hmm. After I got hurt and I was home, and even after I started working at part-time at the 911 center, I knew that that wasn't going to be the end all. But yeah. I think like in a lot of ways in your life, after you've had a spinal cord injury, I think you just need to put yourself out there. You need to get out of that comfort zone. You'll hear it referred to as, and just push boundaries, get out there and just try stuff. And it's a little crazy what you can do. You know, I was working part-time, but before working for the Spinal Cord Injury Association, and the challenge that brings on to, you know, go ahead and be independent in your care and everything like a para, you got to figure should.
Yeah.
Maybe you don't make that leap until you're forced to, and then, you know, when for work, you have to make a 3-4 day trip. Well, it sort of forces you to get your transportation squared away and get your care and get your old routine squared away and be more independent that you're able to do that. Then it benefits you in the other parts of your life.
Wow. Well, that was some really good advice. Sounds like, and I was going to ask you a little bit about Sand Rider, but are you still doing the beach chair stuff or is that a side gig?
So I'm from Pittsburgh originally and moved to the beach.
Okay.
And I'm sure going to want to be on the beach. And none of the existing equipment really did a very good job.
Okay.
I had rented them in the past, and they're just unbelievably difficult to use and hard to transport and frankly, ugly, and you'd really want to be seen in that thing. Our family, being entrepreneurs, entrepreneurial spirited people as we've always been, mm-hmm. I wasn't here at Virginia Beach 6 months till we started doing some prototyping. And about a year later, we had a pretty good solid prototype and took it to the beach. That turned into a 6-year business. We subsequently sold that business, but I remain involved as a consultant.
That's so cool. All right. You're just interesting to me. I love this. Okay. Well, unfortunately, I have to stop it here, but I want to thank you again, Bill, for sharing, your employment success story with us. It's really great. And I think your story is going to help a lot of people listening. So thanks again. And hopefully we'll talk to you again at some point in the future.
Thanks so much for the invitation, Tiffany.
Absolutely. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.